ಜನ ಅಧಿನಾಯಕ ಜಯ ಹೇ ಭಾರತ ಭಾಗ್ಯ ವಿಧಾತಾ ಪಂಜಾಬ ಸಿಂಧ ಗುಜರಾತ ಮರಾಠ ದ್ರಾವಿಡ ಉತ್ಕಳ ಬಂಗಾ ವಿಂಧ್ಯ ಹಿಮಾಚಲ ಯಮುನಾ ಗಂಗಾ ಉಚ್ಚಲ ಜಲಧಿ ತರಂಗಾ ತವ ಶುಭ ನಾಮೇ ಜಾಗೇ ತವ ಶುಭ ಆಶಿಷ ಮಾಗೇ ಗಾಹೇ ತವ ಜಯ ಗಾಥಾ ಜನಗಣ ಮಂಗಳದಾಯಕ ಜಯ ಹೇ ಭಾರತ ಭಾಗ್ಯ ವಿಧಾತಾ ಜಯ ಹೇ ಜಯ ಹೇ ಜಯ ಹೇ ಜಯ 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 ಹೇ.
It's now time for the Israel National Anthem.
Good evening to you, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Pankaj Dave, and today I'm going to be the MC for this event. I've been with Canada India Foundation for nearly a decade. It's a great organization working with Indo-Canadian community on a public policy advocacy sphere. First of all, I would thank all of you for being here after this busy evening. And I really, we behalf of CIF, thank you, each and every of you. Today, we are celebrating 150 years of formation of Canada, 70 years of Indian independence, and 25 years of Indo-Israel diplomatic relationship. It's a great landmark. Someone may ask, when our planet is 4.5 billion years old, what's the significance of 25, 70, or even 150 years? But the answer is that these are the landmarks and these are the milestones in the human civilization. This also reminded to us that what kind of challenges we have passed through, what kind of achievements and accomplishments we have achieved in the last few years. And today the great examples are Canada, India, and Israel. Those have been standing today on the world map as an example of great democracy with a great, vibrant inclusiveness. That's what we are going to talk today. It has been a quest of humankind to what's the best form of government and what is the acceptable form of government. Today, democracy has been the, I won't say this perfect form of government, been certainly unrivaled to be the best. As Winston Churchill has said, democracy is the worst form of government except for all the others. And to be fair, my wife didn't know that why I brought her over here. But I think that she will have a lot of takeaway after knowing about democracy. we are going to begin with an invoking dance, dance prayer by the young girls of Nritya Kala Mandir that symbolizes the faith in supreme power and seeking the blessings of for all. I will call upon the artists of Nritya Kala group to perform. Nritya Kala Mandir is a school of Indian classical dance as 2001 by Mrs. Bhatt, and it has been in last during 16 years the students of this school have performed Indian classical folk as well as Bollywood style dances at countless community events. Give a big round of applause to these young girls of Nritya Kala Mandir.
Tick, 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 tick. அடகாதி பிரியம் மூஷிகாகனமோதக பிரியம் மகாகணபதிம் மனச ஸ்மராமி வசிஷ்ட வாமதேவாதி மந்திர 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 மந்திர
get different thoughts, different views expressed in a forum where people can appreciate it. I would like to welcome all the speakers, Consul General from Israel, Dalit Baram, Consul General from India, Ambassador Dinesh Bhatiaji, the MP who's the current chair of the Indo-Canada Friendship Society, Ramesh Sangha, and MPP Amrit Mangaji. Thank you all for blessing us with your participation in today's workshop. I'd like to thank all the members of the Board of Governors of the Canada Foundation who are here, especially two of them, especially because they worked so hard in getting this program together. One is, of course, Pankaj Dave, and the other is Satish Thakkar. Also, I'd like to thank our Executive Director, Vipul Jani. I don't know where he is, but he's still organizing some stuff. And for all his hard work, this forum is here, well, there he is. This forum is here to discuss inclusiveness and democracies. But before that, let me give you a little bit of background about CIF. Because some of you, this might be the first experience of Canada India Foundation. Canada India Foundation was created 10 years ago by a select group of individuals to spread public policy advocacy in Canada. What does that mean? It means to get India and Canada closer politically, economically. It means to get Indo-Canadians into the public policy process. It means to get Indo-Canadians into benches, into boards, into legislatures, and positions where they can contribute their time and effort to making this great country even greater. It means to make Canadians aware about the changing face of India. Our first speaker in the Canada-India Foundation Speaker Series was the President of the Canadian Association of Petroleum Products. The second was the Honorary Consul General of Israel. So this is a repeat performance this today for her, right? And the third was a TV show host and journalist, Mr. Tariq Fatah, who said he was going to be here today, but I haven't seen him so far. A learned scholar and a controversial straight shooter. And let me just remind you, Canada India Foundation does not shy away from controversies. We face it head on and we let you decide. This year is special. It's 150 years or sesquicentennial since Old British India, New Brunswick and Nova Scotia became the Dominion of Canada, with Ontario, Quebec, New Brunswick and Nova Scotia as provinces. This is a celebratory year for all of us. We should all, as Canadians, be proud that we live in Canada. This year is special because it's 70 years since the independence of India, after one of the bloodiest forced migrations of Hindus, Sikhs, and Muslims. Yet, the carnage gave birth to the largest and most complex of democracies. 780 languages, 22 official with their own script, people of almost all races, color, creed, caste. Maoists to capitalists, religious bigots to atheists. India was born a democracy and will continue to be one. Finally, it's 25 years of formalized Israel-India relationship. Although Israelis and Jews have been to India since 562 BC. Although Israelis in India had a forward relationship from God knows when, since 1947, I think. Although Israel was created in 1948. It's a homeland that was created of need. It's a homeland where the nation has sacrificed millions of their lives and is yet to find peace in its neighborhood, but is striving for it every day, every moment of its life. Inclusiveness and democracies. Democracies without inclusiveness is democracy only in name, they say. One person, one vote is found in countries held by military, sectarian, and religious leaders, but the power is never with the people, or the power is never held for the people. Having a perception of free press is also not inclusiveness. We know of so-called military democracies limiting the role of the press to ask only the easy questions, not to ask tough questions, not to ask questions about the treatment of minorities or forced conversions or punishment under blasphemy laws. We know that. So this level of inclusiveness of press is not the inclusiveness that we Canadians think about. Dynasty politics, keeping women and minorities out of power, cannot be true hallmarks of an inclusive democracy. We are here to listen to the views about inclusive democracy from experts in the field of modern democracy. One representing a country where a prime minister used to be a rail side tea seller. Another representing a country that is practicing democracy but has no other democracy like it till it reaches the shores of India on the eastern side. and finally, representatives of the country where we live. It is truly a country that practices democracy to the extent that sometimes it can be accused of overstepping inclusiveness into what I call pandering of probably minorities, into what happened recently. Everybody knows, I don't need to repeat it, but sorry, if you want to clap, please go ahead. Pandering is not inclusiveness. Inclusiveness is where the mosaic is different. Each part of the mosaic is different, but each part is unique and shines by itself. Pandering does not mean that some parts shine and the others don't. There has to be a national character in the mosaic. There has to be a national fiber in the mosaic. These are our views, but let's hear from the best as to what is their view about inclusiveness in democracy. Given this background of needing inclusiveness and resisting pandering, between this background of having a national connective fabric, I invite our guests to feel free and talk from their hearts about their views and their perspectives. Thank you all. But just before I finish off, I would like to thank Ontario 150 for making this happen. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Ajit, for your welcoming remarks. In this event, this evening, we've got many organizations together. They've supported us. Panorama India, Indo-Canada Chamber of Commerce, representatives also I see over here. So it is a thank you to all of you. We are going to talk about our friendly country, Israel. And in this case, the year 2017 becomes remarkable, and it is another milestone for them. It's 100 years of welfare declaration, which was a precursor of today's Israel when it was formed in 1948. So we also celebrate that. And as I say, 25 years of Indo-Israel diplomatic relationship also we are going to celebrate here this evening. It completes 100 years of welfare declaration, which was I talked about. For these 100 years, the thought itself was certainly, it has passed through its many, many challenges. But today, in a very short span of independence, since 1948, this country has, against all ill-wishing elements and countless challenges, Israel has today 34th largest economy in the world. It is, thank you. Not only that, but you see what's happening in fact in Middle East, surrounded by all sorts of problems, Israel has been an oasis of democracy and inclusiveness. So once again, let us congratulate Israel, our friendly country today. Let's see some audiovisual I request to play and have the glimpses of this great country.
When you hear the word Israel, what goes through your mind? Probably this image, or this, definitely this. So here are 68 facts you probably didn't know about Israel. Israel is a young country. How young? Just 68 years old. In nation years, that's like 3 years old, a mere baby. Israel's population is just 1.6% of the entire population in the Middle East and takes up only 0.1% of the region's area, which means it's tiny. Basically, you can cross the entire country in less than 5 hours from snow-covered Mount Hermon to the sizzling beaches of Eilat. Israel is third in the world in the consumption of sweets and vegetables. Israel was the first country in the world to ban commercial starring underweight models. Israel has the highest number of academics per capita in the world and the highest proportion of startups and of museums as well. Tel Aviv is home to 80,000 dogs that enjoy more than 60 dog parks. And the biggest dog cemetery dating back to ancient times was discovered in Israel in Ashkelon. Speaking of ancient places, Jerusalem, one of the oldest cities in the world, is also the smartest one, as it was the first in the world to be completely covered by Wi-Fi, which you'll need to find one of the best hostels in the world, the Abraham Hostel in Jerusalem. Another ancient city is Be'er Sheva, 4,000 years old. Nowadays, it has the most chess masters per capita in the world. With all due respect to chess, the most popular beach sport in Israel, and probably its national sport, is matkot. There's no score, just the fun of ruining the quiet of the seashore. Books. Israel is number two in the world in book publishing. People of the book, remember? Wait, who's number one? At least we're in first place when it comes to translating literary masterpieces from foreign languages. The USB stick is an Israeli invention which saves us lots of storage space. Israel is among the 10 leading countries in life expectancy. Folks here live on average to the ripe old age of 83. Israel has 273 kilometers of beaches, hugging the Mediterranean Sea, the Red Sea, the Dead Sea, and the Sea of Galilee, the lowest sweetwater lake in the world. According to the New Testament, Jesus walked on the water here. This rescue board is called a hasaker. It was invented here in the 1930s by a Jewish lifeguard. If you have a problem staying above water, the Dead Sea is the place for you. The salt concentration there is so high, anyone can stay afloat. Israel is one of only 8 countries that have sent a satellite into space. The busiest bird migration route in the world goes through Israel. 1 billion birds pass through here every year. According to Traveler's Digest, Tel Aviv is in the top 10 for cities with the world's most beautiful women. And yes, also among the top 10 when it comes to good-looking men. But women in Israel have much more to offer than just a pretty face. Israeli women also have more academic degrees than the men do. So if you are the next Marie Curie, this is the place for you. Not for nothing is Israel known as the startup nation. There are more than 3,000 high-tech companies and startups in Israel. That's the highest concentration in the world outside of Silicon Valley. So what was invented here? The technology that allows us to chat in WhatsApp, Messenger, and everything else you youngsters spend your time on. The world's first antivirus software, gesture-controlled and hands-free computers. Technology to prevent traffic accidents. Taxi service app. Remember when you had to wave your hand for a taxi? A social network that allows you to steer clear of traffic jams. A really small pill that can photograph your body from the inside. How does it get out? Solar energy water heater. Irrigation system that conserves water. Painless hair removal. Well, almost painless. Anti-jellyfish sting gel. Laser keyboard. The technology that enabled unmanned flight. Cherry tomatoes. And Rummy Cup, the popular board game. Whew. Crembo, chocolate-coated marshmallow treat. It may originally have been a Danish confection, but in the winter, Israelis eat more than 50 million Crembos. Bamba, a peanut-flavored snack created in Israel. On top of being popular and delicious, research has shown that it helps children build immunity to peanut allergy. And to continue with the yummy stuff, even though Italy is the birthplace of ice cream, consumption in Israel is 10 liters a year. Respect! And brain freeze. Ice cream is all about the quality of the milk. Israeli cows are world champions in milk production. Since she's a champion, she's got an attitude. Tel Aviv is known as one of the vegan capitals of the world. Or how about some sushi? Tel Aviv is only second to Tokyo in sushi bars per square meter. Wine has been made here for more than 3,000 years. And even then, the local wine industry didn't win as many international awards as it does today. And speaking of prestigious awards, none is more prestigious than the Nobel, right? 9 Israelis have won the Nobel Prize in Sciences. The last one was Professor Dan Shechtman for the discovery of the quasi-periodic crystal. See if you can say 5 times really fast quasi-periodic crystal. Israel also grows flowers, lots of flowers. For last Valentine's Day, Israel shipped more than 60 million flowers to Europe. Israel is the only democracy in the Middle East. Israel is not a monarchy, but does have a queen. Her name is Dana International, and she's the first transgender to win the Eurovision contest. Time Out magazine has crowned Tel Aviv as gay capital of the Middle East. And speaking of divas, Lady Gaga's shoe designer is Israeli. They are indeed beautiful, but really difficult to walk in, especially if you're in Haifa and need to climb its green hills. For that, the shortest train line in the world was constructed to take you right to the top of Mount Carmel. And while we're in Haifa, did you know that it is the most multi-ethnic city in Israel? It has Jews, Christians, Muslims, both Sunnis and Shias, Druze and Baha'is. Did you know that Israel is the only place in the world where the number of trees increases year by year? Even with all these forests, 60% of Israel is desert, which didn't prevent us from turning the barren desert into productive farmland. A desert doesn't have much water, so Israel was forced to lead the world in desalination technologies. Israeli scientists developed treatments for multiple sclerosis, Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, and most important, discovered the cause of halitosis. Yes, yes, bad breath. Israelis are also not too shabby when it comes to sports. Maccabi Tel Aviv took the European Championship 6 times. In judo and windsurfing, Israel is an Olympic powerhouse. And if you're still not impressed, what would you say to the fact that the Emmy-winning series Homeland was written in Israel? Or that more than 1 million notes are stuffed into the Western Wall every year. Where does God find the time to read them all? And Hebrew is such an ancient language that if a modern-day Israeli would meet his ancestor from 2,000 years ago, they would be able to carry on a conversation. One more left? Well, all right. Have you heard of the Global Happiness Index? Neither had I until now. But apparently, Israelis are in the 11th spot out of 196 countries. And if that doesn't satisfy you, maybe you should find someone to talk to about it.
Hello. What a magnificent story of this country. Is not making us inspired only, but also proud of our friendly country, Israel. Friends, we have got a representative of Ekal Vidyalay Canada and also of HSS Canada, overseas friends of BJP, and also IYD representatives. Thank you very much for coming here. Our next speaker I'm going to introduce here, you all are waiting for, I know that. Let me welcome our special guest tonight. It's Ms. Galit Ram, the Consul General of here in Toronto. Consul General Galit Ram was born in Jerusalem, in Israel, holding an exemplary academic credentials. She has a bachelor's degree in archaeology and English from Tel Aviv University, followed by a master's degree in American Studies from the Hebrew University, Jerusalem. She speaks, three languages, Hebrew, English, and Russian. Previously, she was posted as a counselor of public affairs and coordinator of academic affairs at the Israeli embassy in Washington, D.C. She has also served her country as a counselor for economic affairs in Cairo and counselor for political affairs in Moscow. Beginning her career with the ministry as a political assistant in the Director General's Bureau with the Department of Eurasia and Caucasus at Ministry Headquarters in Jerusalem, Peter held the position of Deputy Director in the same department. Prior to her current posting, Ms. Baram served as a Director of the Department of Palestine Affairs and Regional Cooperation. In August 2016, Ms. Baram arrived in Toronto to take up her current position as a Consul General. Welcome, Consul General of Israel, Ms. Galit.
Hello, good evening. I'm very, very honored to be here and to represent my country. I'm grateful for the Canadian Indian Foundation. Dear Ajit, thank you very much for inviting me and including Israel in this very special evening, very beautiful event. I'm honored to be in the presence of my colleague, Indian Consul General Dinesh Bhatia. We speak very often about our communities, the Jewish community here in Toronto and the Indian community. We compare notes, we diplomats do that. And it's always a pleasure, a dear and respected friend, very respected in the diplomatic community here in Toronto. And I would like to acknowledge the MP Sangha and MPP Mangat. Thank you very much for attending this event. It's a great honor. It's a great pleasure to meet you. I was requested to talk a little bit about inclusiveness and about my country and about Israel-India relations. And Ajit was very firm about it. He said that I'm given 10 minutes or less to talk about all these subjects, so I'll try to do my best and bear with me. Definitely you watched the film and you saw my amazing little country in the Middle East. Definitely when it comes to sizes, then Israel is definitely one of the smallest countries in the world with a growing population. It will not impress you as Canadians. It will not impress you as people of Indian descent. But the population is in Israel is 8.5 million people. This is what we have. A very small country, fundamentally different. But there are many similarities when it comes to India and Israel and Canada as well. First of all, ancient history that was discussed here, the fact that both countries, India and Israel, received their independence from Great Britain Israel was under a British mandate, and therefore there is a very strong influence of British mandate in Israel. Both are staunch democracies, despite many difficulties and many challenges. And we do have a very diverse population in Israel. Just to mention, the Israeli Defense Forces unites pretty much Israeli society. This is our melting pot, and we have Jews and Arabs serving together, Christian, Muslim, Jewish, Druze and Circassian, men and women. Israel is the only country in the world in which military service is mandatory for women as well. Religious and secular people serve together, immigrants and Israeli born. And we fight for our country, and we defend our country. We defend our values, values that we share both with India and with Canada, values of equality and democracy. It is indeed a colorful tapestry of people who came to Israel from all over the world, people who were born in the country, and they have different languages, different religions and traditions. And this, of course, brings with it many difficulties. Many difficulties and challenges when it comes to integrating all these voices, all these opinions into one functioning democracy, one functioning country. We live in a very problematic region. I believe the Middle East is one of the most troubled regions in the world, a tough neighborhood, and we've had our fair share of wars and terror attacks. So definitely when it comes to counterterrorism, we concentrate on that as well. And we share this experience with our Indian friends. Just to mention two cases in which Israeli backpackers were attacked in Kashmir in 1991, and another case, the terror attacks in Mumbai in 2008, which took the lives of many Indian citizens and some Israelis among them as well. Six Israelis were killed. So definitely when it comes to counterterrorism, we have a very bitter lesson that we share, of course, with India. And of course, the major achievements. When it comes to our country in the Middle East, we have no oil, we have no gas, we have no natural resources. The only resource that we have is our minds and our good education and our leading universities. And I would like to talk a bit about immigrants and about the great value of immigrants to the societies in which they live. Immigrants function as a human bridge between cultures. And they provide, I would say, a uniting element in their communities. They contribute greatly, both here in Canada and in other countries as well. Just to give you an example about the Indian community in Israel, we absorbed quite a large number of immigrants from India in Israel. Very large numbers, and I could exhaust you with information about the Iraqi Baghdadi Jews and Bnei Israel and the Jews of Cochin and Bnei Menashe and Bnei Ephraim from all over India who moved to Israel and contributed greatly to Israeli society. So definitely these immigrants from India contributed greatly to building bridges between Israel and India in formative years for both young countries. But I have to tell you very frankly that what actually build bridges between India and Israel are tourists and Israeli backpackers who flocked to India and still flock to India in very large numbers after they finished their military service. It's almost a rite of passage for many Israelis after they're done with their military service to save some money and to go to India and spend several months, up to a year, traveling around the country, getting to know the people, and Israelis simply fall in love with India. And I have to tell you that Indian citizens have been very patient with Israelis because they tend to be loud and we travel in hordes and we attract a lot of attention, and our young men and women sometimes get in trouble, and it's up to us Israeli diplomats to get them out of trouble and to bring them back home safely. They're the ones who learned the country, studied in and fell in love with the country, and when they return, to Israel, then contribute greatly to bringing our two countries together.
The same situation happens here in Canada with the Jewish community. People who move to Canada, Jews from Europe, and they're fully integrated in Canadian society. Among them, by the way, there are about
70,000 Israelis who live here in Canada. And they see Canada as a blessing, as a beacon of multiculturalism, of inclusiveness, and their beloved home. And we respect that, and we enjoy the very close relations that we have with the Jewish community here in Canada. Now, a few words about political cooperation between our two countries. The beginning maybe was a bit tough, but now that during the time of Prime Minister Modi, we see a dramatic rise in bilateral relations, in mutual visits. So definitely the visit of Prime Minister Modi added to strengthening relations between Israel and India and brought our countries even further together. Definitely when it comes to cooperation in agriculture and water management and high-tech, pharmaceutical research and production, R&D in general, and of course political relations that are very close and very friendly. With Canada as well, we were lucky enough to share this very strong bond, full cooperation in the international arena when it comes to political relations, to security, to regional security, economic cooperation, and cultural and academic exchange. Plenty of political visits, and I'm not going to exhaust you here with all this information, but when it comes to Canada and India, these are extremely friendly countries to Israel in the international arena, and we cooperate with the governments of both countries very closely on a daily basis at the Israeli Ministry of Foreign Affairs. I attribute that, all these major achievements of Israel in the international arena, to the human factor. I believe that relations between countries are based, it's true, on diplomacy and politics and economic interests. This is all true. But at a certain point, governments take a step back and to leave the rest of the work for the people, for the population itself. And relations between countries are based and should be based on love, mutual respect, and mutual understanding. When it comes to Canada, for me, the two pictures that stick to my mind when I think about India is the visit of Israeli President Rivlin and his wife sitting on a bench, holding hands and looking at the Taj Mahal. It is the image of Prime Ministers Netanyahu and Modi standing barefoot and talking on the beach of the Mediterranean in Tel Aviv. And my own husband, a career diplomat, always in a suit and a tie, this is how I know him. But there is a picture hanging in our house with him wearing a pair of jeans, wearing a coat, carrying an enormous backpack, crossing a bridge, hanging over a river somewhere in India. And this is a picture that is closest to his heart. How lucky we are to celebrate our relations. Thank you very much for your time, and I wish you an enjoyable and wonderful evening. Thank you.
This evening we are going to bring another piece of entertainment over here, and now we'll have a dance presented by spirit dancers. The spirit dancers are the traditional territory of the Mississaugas of the New Credit First region.
So, the names of these artists are Silent Morrison, Angel Recollet, Wazamide Recollet, Alana Webbing
Wongs, and Jaden Webbing Wongs. Thank you. Let's enjoy this dance.
Thank you.
Thank you, Alice.
Democracy is a continuous evolution from the ethnic democracy or Armenian republics to the modern form of democracy. It is really continuous the process of evolution. And inclusiveness is an Armenian extension of democracy. There is a fair democratic values means fair and just engagement with the commoner in each and every facet of life, like politics, economics, and social development. Canada is a symbol of pluralism and inclusiveness. Those are the basic Canada. Our biggest also, let's watch an audiovisual Canada.
Very much. Our next speaker is our own Member of Parliament, Ramesh Sangha. Currently, he's the Member of Parliament for the riding of Brampton Center. MP Sangha is also the chair of the Canada-India Parliamentary Friendship Group. And that way, our association with Mr. Sangha becomes further special. Our request, Mr. Sangha.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's really a great honor for me to be here today among you all. And thank you for CIF to give me this opportunity to be in front of you. Let me first of all recognize our excellencies, Madam Gilad Baram, Consulate General of our Israel, and Mr. Dharesh Bhatia, Consul General for India, Toronto. You all know Mr. Dharesh Bhatia. He is a great person, a great link between India and Canada. He is now a part of the GTA community. He has tried his best to bring the community close. NRIs are really like him personally. That's the way he is. And to the India Friendship Group, Executive Member of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association, a member of the Huma Committee. I'm really thankful to all the community members, those who have given me the opportunity to be a parliamentarian with these designations. where on the one side I am proud of to be a parliamentarian, and same time I'm honored to be among all of you at this event to discuss about inclusiveness and democracies. These three democracies, Israel, India, and Canada, are flourishing in a great way. India is as the biggest democracy in the world. And we all, being NRIs, sometimes feel proud of it because we belong to that country too. Our Prime Minister, Right Honorable Justin Trudeau, today must be sure that he will be proud to know that this vision of fostering global collaboration is bearing the fruit, and it all happened here in Canada, that too is done. Let's all put our all hands for India Friendship Group, all the board members, to give them enthusiasm doing this great job and celebrating 150 Canada. Canada is 150 years young now, growing strong day by day. Canada recognizes, promotes exclusiveness of the democracies and provides equal opportunity to each and everyone. Our Prime Minister recognizes that providing our youth with the skill to gain meaningful employment is the key training, attaining the better quality of the life, sustaining dignity, and ultimately eradicating global poverty. And that's why Parliamentary Friendship Group and the committees are formed by the independent democratic countries, where all the members from both the houses, from all the parties, take part into the process to study how democracies are flourishing in the world. And that's what we do. And that's what is exclusiveness. So what exclusiveness is all about. So ultimately goal is to promote the parliamentary system, parliamentary relationship between the countries like Canada, India, and Israel. Pursuing trilateral collaboration such as this Canada-India Foundation initiative is a great testament. And I again congratulate you for this. Israel and India are robustly booming economies, and the Canada too has its own name as a leader at the global level. So when the three countries will collaborate together and work together, we are already working, but we can improve more, score better service possible. That's what Right Honorable Justin Trudeau, our Prime Minister, says. But let me get back to the collaboration. How can we collaborate, or what really collaboration is? To me, we must be able to and willing to combine our talents and the art together when we talk about the collaboration. That's the way we share the values. That's the way we share the culture, social values of everyone, other countries, when we sit together. When these countries like Israel, India, they are evolving in the fields of economy, science, technology, and agriculture, these countries can work. Surely, the leaders of these countries has given new directions to the countries. Prime Minister Modi, he has taken the new steps by which he claims, not only claims, he do the things which are possibly, which can be used for the betterment of not only India, but for the other countries when we work collaboratively. Being an executive member of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association, I had the chance to go India, visit Gujarat, and I was really astonished when how Mackay, our factory here from Canada, is flourishing there in India. Not only that, there are many other concerns, many other businesses which are flourishing. So we are working together. Working together, and we are doing better. So when we see these factories and concerns are growing up, and we give the chance from other countries, from India, to come to Canada and invest here and give their intellect, and the art and the education which can be used here in Canada, surely it will be beneficial to both the countries. Thank you. Let's continue to work together to ensure better quality of life for our youth and seniors all across the globe. Canada is leading ahead. Again, let me thank to Canada-India Friendship and for playing their role and taking the lead in coming forward with this today's seminar. Thank you for the organizers and to all the other associations, those who have come up to join this function, and the artists, those who are performing here. And a special thanks to Anand Singh, whose O Canada was displayed here. I would like another thing, to come up here to the stage and give your presence here. I congratulate his father, Harjinder Singh, and mom, Rajinder Kaur, for your son doing a great job. Thank you very much for doing it. I have got a few certificates from the Government of Canada to hand over to His Excellencies, both Excellencies, if you can please come up and honor me in accepting these certificates.
Next speaker is going to be our friend of Canada India Foundation, MPP Amrit Mangat. Representing the riding of Mississauga Brampton South, Amrit is currently, she serves as the parliamentary assistant to the minister responsible for women's issue and the minister responsible for accessibility. She also sits on the cabinet committee for jobs and economic policy. And as I told, she has been a staunch supporter of Canada India Foundation. Ms. Mangat, please.
Thank you, Pankaji, for your kind words. Good evening, friends. Consul General of Israel, Consul General of India, and Member Parliament, Mr. Sangha. I'm really delighted to be here this evening. First of all, I would like to thank CIF for hosting this important event. The theme, Celebrating Inclusiveness and Democracies, is fascinating. As we all know, inclusiveness and diversity go hand in hand. Friends, I have said it many times before, and I'm going to reiterate that I was blessed to be born and raised in India, a multicultural country. And I'm fortunate enough to choose Canada as my home, which is also a multicultural country. Recently, I read an article. There are 800 language and ethnic groups in India who live together in an inclusive society and in democratic system. Similarly, Ontario and Canada's strength lies in its diversity and democratic values. So, Canada and India have much in common. Each and every Indo-Canadian is an unofficial ambassador. So we have a duty to do the best for our homeland and our home. Organizations like CIF also play an important role in bringing countries together, in bringing governments and businesses together, and in strengthening social, cultural, and economic bonds. And this evening is a very much reflective of that. And I saw it firsthand when our government took trade mission to India in early 2016 under the leadership of our Premier Honorable Kathleen Wynne. CIF played a crucial role, and we signed deals worth $240 million just in 4 days. Them a big, big round of applause. As we are celebrating Canada 150, Ontario 150, and 70 years of India's independence and 25 years of Indo-Israel diplomatic relations, I'm very proud of each and every one of you and all the Indo-Canadians who have made their contributions to build Canada and the progress India has achieved in these years. Let's continue to work together to further enhance our bilateral, our trilateral, multilateral relationship in today's globalized economy. Thank you. Enjoy the rest of the evening.
Thank you very much, MPP Mangat, for your encouraging remarks. I would like to once again appreciate the support and kind cooperation of ICCC over here. We see that board members, many board members of ICCC were here. And once again, we acknowledge the support and cooperation we have got from Ontario 150. When we talk about India, it's a civilization of 5,000 years plus years, and a unique blend of cultural heritage and modern advancement of technology. India is a very special role it has in the world map. A country that is on growth trajectory right now, that is passing through a holistic renaissance. Let's have a quick glimpse of India and Indo-Canadians.
As we awake a new glorious dawn, the 70th Independence Day anniversary of our motherland, we salute its rich history and culture. and acknowledge its rich intellectual, spiritual, and natural bounty. A land vibrant with a remarkably resilient and spirited people. It is time to remember. This is the land which welcomed all, friend and foe alike. A land where a guest is treated like a god. Atithi Devo Bhava. That is our heritage. This is our culture. Sometimes offering relief as a refuge. Sometimes profiting out of our rich natural resources as a trading partner. All who came were soon assimilated by a peace-loving culture. Peoples of the world clamored and vied with each other to establish and maintain links with India. A land of fabulous riches. So rich was our natural bounty. So sure were they at the prospect of huge gains that it was known as Sone Ki Chidiya or the Golden Bird. Today, we are awakening to a new dawn. A dawn fueled by the dreams of our most abundant resource, our resourceful and energetic people. Under the direction of the broad vision of Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji, India is waking up to a whole new chapter in our nation's development.
मैं आज लाल किले की प्राचीर से विश्व भर में लोगों से कहना चाहता हूं, कम मेक इन इंडिया, केमिकल्स के लेकर के फार्मास्यूटिकल तक, कम मेक इन इंडिया, ऑटोमोबाइल से लेकर के एग्रो वैल्यू एडिशन तक, कम मेक इन इंडिया, पेपर हो या प्लास्टिक, कम मेक इन इंडिया, सम सैटेलाइट हो या सम मरीन, कम मेक इन इंडिया।
And our people are a result of this lofty ideal, a unique mix of old and new, making for a great nation of tomorrow. We are waking up to a whole new episode in our nation's development. The new India is emerging, large on the world's horizon. India managed to keep the crown as the world's number one location for capital investment for the second year running, ahead of China and the US. Capital investment speaks and is the strongest indicator of future growth. Even space is not the limit in this fast-moving, vibrant economy. The achievements are remarkable considering the frugal budget of the Indian Space Research Organization, which has made a name for itself for low-cost, high-return space missions. Coming back to Earth, and the many who migrated from India to settle in all parts of the world, contributing their hard work and intelligence to the nations they call home.
मैं बहुत भाग्यशाली हूँ, मेरे देशवासी जिन्होंने हजारों मील दूर यहाँ रह करके भारत की आन बान शान को बढ़ाया है.
The Minister of External Affairs and Minister Srimati Sushma Swaraj has taken proactive steps to rope in the support and goodwill of the 29 million NRIs under the umbrella of Pravasiya Bharatiya Organization.
मुझे सबसे ज्यादा गर्व की अनुभूति तब होती है जब मैं एक साधारण आम भारतीय के बारे में बाहर जाकर सुनती हूँ कि भारतीयों में तीन गुण होते हैं. एक तो भारतीय बहुत अच्छा पड़ोसी होता है, वो किसी के भी सुख दुख में पहुंच जाता है. भारतीय बहुत परिश्रमी होता है, वो नखरे से नौकरी नहीं करता. और तीसरा, वो कानून पसंद होता है.
The non-resident Indian was never far from India, though miles away, because he has India in his heart.
भारत माता की, भारत माता की, भारत माता की.
So we have got another prolific speaker now on this evening, and the very much familiar face within Indian community over here in Canada, especially in GTA, our Consul General India to Toronto, Mr. Dinesh Bhatia. I would just give Mr. Dinesh Bhatia is well known for almost everyone knows about. Prior to joining the current post, His Excellency Dinesh Bhatia was Ambassador of India to Cote d'Ivoire, Guinea, and Liberia, and residing in Abidjan. He's an alumnus of National Defense College. Ambassador Bhatia also participated in the 4th Joint Civil-Military Course on National Security in Lal Bahadur Shastri National Academy of Administration, Missouri. He has also authored a book on Physics of Civil Services Preliminary Examination. Having served in various Indian missions abroad, including Madrid, Spain, Kathmandu, Nepal, and Kuwait, Ambassador Bhatia was seconded by the Government of India to Department of Atomic Energy, Mumbai, and as Private Secretary to Tourism Ministry of India. Let's welcome His Excellency Dinesh Bhatia.
Hello, good evening, namaskar. My friend, Consul General of Israel, Galit Baram, Member of Parliament, Ramesh Sanghaji, MPP, Amrit Mangatji, Chair of CIF, Ajit Someshwar, his team, friends, brothers and sisters. I have been given an onerous task to talk about democracy, inclusiveness, India-Israel relations, and India-Canada relations in 7 to 8 minutes. I don't think even if God, Lord Krishna, had to come down, he would be able to do that. So pardon me for all the slips that are going to happen now, because in no way this is possible to cover all this subject in about 7-8 minutes. It might take hours, it might take a full seminar, a 2-day seminar to cover these subjects. But let me begin by what Mahatma Gandhi wrote about democracy. He said, "My notion of democracy is that under it, the weakest should have the same opportunity as the strongest." To Mahatma Gandhi, there were 4 pillars of democracy: equity, representation, freedom, and justice. The 3 countries that we are talking about today, India, Israel, and Canada, they all have democracy, they have a well-written constitution, and all the 3 pillars of democracy, including legislature, executive, and judiciary, are there enshrined in the respective constitutions. All the 3 countries have universal adult suffrage, giving voting rights to everyone over a certain age. In India, of course, it's the age of 18. We all 3 countries also have a 3-tier judicial system. In India, since I come from India, apart from the political democracy, Indian Constitution also guarantees social democracy through the liberty, equality, and fraternity, which are enshrined in the Constitution of India. Today, India is the largest functioning democracy in the world, and it has a strong pillar of diversity and inclusion. Diversity is based on several factors, including ethnicity, gender, age, national origin, disability, sexual orientation, education, religion, caste, in case of India too. And inclusion is a state of being valued, respected, and supported. It's about focusing on the needs of every individual and ensuring the right conditions are in place for each person to achieve his or her full potential. In simple terms, diversity is the mix, and inclusion is getting the mix to work. India, in a way, epitomizes inclusiveness. With 22 languages recognized by the Constitution of India and over 700 dialects spoken all over the country, with 550 plus districts in the country, with a population of 1.3 billion. I must give you an instance of the parliamentary elections, the last parliamentary elections in 2014. We had more than 814 million registered voters, 814 million registered voters. No other country can boast of this number. And with 66% people actually voting, we had more than 500 million people going to the voting centers and voting eventually. Physically voting in the elections, more than 500 million population. Can any other country imagine that? No other country can imagine that. Let me come to the state of Israel. And before I talk about Israel, I must, Galit, do you remember I had discussed with you in our last lunch when we had met at the residence of Japanese colleague. There's an author called Barry Brown. He has just published a book about a couple of months back. And he's a Toronto-based Jewish author. He writes in his book, the book is called Humanity, The World Before Religion, War and Inequality. In this book called Humanity, he writes, and now this is his theory, and he has done a lot of research, original research. He says that the entire Jewish clan or the community migrated from the banks of Ganges, Ganga River in India, after the end of Mahabharat war, and they went to Middle East. This is his theory, written by a Jewish author. And the book is available. I have got a copy of the book. It's available on Amazon. You can read it. And then, of course, he has linked it with the Indus Valley Civilization. And he has gone even before that, 10,000 years BC. But I will not get into detail of that. I also recall when I was doing, and Pankaji mentioned very generously my CV. In my CV, I have done this course called National Defense College. It's about 47-week course, which I did over the period of entire 2011. And I remember the Israeli ambassador to India came and lectured us. We had these modules where the foreign ambassadors came and talked to us. And he said that there's one word which defines Israel, and the word is called innovation. And I tend to agree with him. I do not know what will describe India or Canada. To me, India may be described as, the first word that comes to my mind is civilization. India is the oldest civilization on earth, and we truly represent that. Today, India-Israel relations are out of closet. Prime Minister Narendra Modi paid an official visit to Israel from 4 to 6 July this year, the first ever visit of an Indian Prime Minister, creating history and also celebrating 25 years of India-Israel diplomatic relations. Very importantly, the visit lasted 2.5 days, one of the longest visits that Prime Minister Modi had in any country. Besides the innovation, India sees Israel as a very important partner in water and agriculture. These are the priority areas for India too. During the visit of Prime Minister Modi, we signed 3 MOUs in these two fields. In addition to this, a bilateral technology innovation fund worth US$40 million for research in industrial development was announced during the visit. India is also the largest buyer of Israeli military equipment, and Israel is the second largest supplier of defense equipment to India after Russia. Israel is also home to 85,000 Indian origin Jews. And there are a large number of Indian students who are now choosing Israel as their destination for research and higher studies. And very interestingly, last week when Prime Minister Netanyahu spoke at General Assembly of United Nations, he mentioned only two visits in his speech, and they were namely visit of the US President Trump and Prime Minister Modi. That shows the closeness between the two leaders. India and Israel live in complex geographies. We are aware of strategic threats to regional peace and stability. India has suffered firsthand the violence and hatred spread by terror. So has Israel. We need to do much more together to protect our strategic interest and also cooperate to combat growing radicalization and terrorism, including in cyberspace. It is India's hope that peace, dialogue, and restraint will prevail. We are talking about India, Israel, and also Canada, which is the third democracy in today's context. Prime Minister Modi paid a visit to Canada as well in April 2015. This was the first visit of Indian Prime Minister after a gap of 42 years. He covered the three major cities in Canada, Ottawa, Toronto, and Vancouver. He addressed a large PIO gathering, person of Indian origin gathering at Toronto, which witnessed about over 10,000 people. Canada today is home to 1.3 million persons of Indian origin, coming from all regions of India, all languages of India, all religions of India. And the PIO community here, the Indo-Canadian community, forms a very strong pillar to the Indian, to the Canadian economy and also the polity. Today we have 21 members of parliament in Canadian parliament of Indian origin. One of them is with us today. Four ministers in Prime Minister Trudeau's government are of Indian origin. And not to forget that we have a very large student population from India. I'm not counting the students who are born, brought up here and studying in universities and colleges, but students who have come from India are numbered over 100,000 today this year. India, Israel, and Canada are vibrant democracies with their very foundations entrenched in the spirit of diversity and inclusiveness. It is therefore natural that countries have come close based on shared values and people-to-people ties. Let me quote towards the end Martin Luther King. He said, "If we are to have peace on earth, our loyalties must become ecumenical rather than sectional. Our loyalties must transcend our race, our tribe, our class, and our nation. And this means we must develop a world perspective." And this same philosophy, which he said, was enshrined in Indian scriptures through the concept of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. That means world is a family for us. And we all believe in this concept till date. The Indian foreign policy has this fundamental pillar of Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, where we treat the entire world as a family. With these words, I want to compliment Canada-India Foundation for taking this initiative of bringing these three countries together in Toronto, 12,000 kilometers from India, of course, and several thousand kilometers from Israel. It's a remarkable initiative by Canada-India Foundation. I commend them. And Constant has been a partner to Canada India Foundation in all its activities. We continue to do so. And before I end, I would be remiss if I do not convey my greetings, my own greetings, my family's greetings, and my Constant's greetings on the auspicious occasion of Navratra, Dashera, and wishing a very happy, prosperous, peaceful Diwali. Have a great Diwali. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Consul General Bhatia. These diplomats, really, sometimes it happens. 7 minutes also, it can be food for thought for another 7 days, probably. Ms. Baram and the Consul General Bhatia, that is very much true for both of you in that case. I will call upon now the next speaker from our Canada-India Foundation, the well-known face here in the Indian community. And now, since last yoga day, he has been yoga more known as yoga proponent. And he's a CIF Board of Governors, Mr. Satish Thakkar, to join with me to please closing remarks.
Good evening, and one thing I can promise, I will be very short. Good evening, friends. Tonight is a celebration of the spirit of three great nations, Canada, India, and Israel. All the three nations are founded, and their philosophy is based upon the foundation, strong foundation of democracy and inclusiveness. A promise to all the people, power, freedom, and liberty. And providing an equal opportunity to all to accomplish the highest of the human endeavor. And to achieve whatever they dream. And tonight, friends, it's a tribute to the most cherished virtue that we respect in the evolution and the journey of mankind, equality, freedom, and diversity. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's raise the toast for that. Friends, we have been gathered today for this very special occasion to celebrate democracy and inclusiveness. And we heard very inspiring talks from our distinguished speakers. Please give a very big round of applause to all. This year marks a very special to us all, as we already heard, celebration of 150 years of Canada's Confederation, 70 years of India's independence, and 25 years of India-Israel diplomatic relations. This year also marks a very special for Canada-India Foundation, as it marks the 10th anniversary of CIF's existence. And for the last 10 years, CIF has been championing, advocating, and creating and fostering an environment to get engaged Indo-Canadian into the policy front, into the political spectrum, and also creating an environment for a stronger Canada-India bilateral relations. And we heard from our chair that any kind of a controversy we take head on. Why? Because we are honest in our approach and sincere in our efforts. So, ladies and gentlemen, please do get involved with CIF's activities. Be part of it. And thank you all for joining this evening. on this very special occasion, and I would like to extend on behalf of Canada India Foundation a sincere thank you to Honorable Consul General Dinesh Bhatia, Honorable Consul General Galit Baram, Honorable MP Ramesh Sangaji, MPP Honorable Amrit Mangatji, and various different diaspora and other organizations for your participation being part of this inclusive event to celebrate these two most cherished virtues together. And I also want to thank you for being coming on such a short notice, because this event was planned in less than 2 weeks. So thank you for responding so quickly and being part of this. Before we bring our final performance of the evening, and then after that, dinner will be served, I want to just thank Pearson Convention Center, the host Fine Indian Cuisine, Nayak Production, and all the media for spreading the good work. And please, for especially to the media, we have ZTV, Y Media, ATN, all other different paper media who has been promoting various diaspora-related, various organization-related event. A sincere thank you for doing a great job. And now, let me take this opportunity to introduce the final performance of the evening. It is an Israel Nirkoda dance performance. The celebration of wheat harvest in Israel has inspired many poems and songs. The Nirkoda dance performers will focus on the joy of the harvesters as they gather the fruit of the land and are thankful for the Mother Earth's gift. Please give a very warm welcome to Nirkoda Israeli dancers of Toronto.
Kulan besat hasil האחים והשרים שם המסר תושבים ומלטפים בצי של לחם
interesting that in all the cultures, each and every nook and corner of the world, if you see that paying gratitude to the Mother Nature at the time of harvesting is so common, and it's very interesting, and this was a part of that. With this, I think formally we are just ending this session this evening. I would request all the attendees to move towards the right-hand side. There is a food going to be served. It's a buffet dinner, and the food is accessible from both the sides. And while it happens, we are going to play an audiovisual message by our national convener, Mr. Anil Shah. Right now he's in Italy, but he has certainly sent a message to all of us. And in the meantime, all the speakers and CIF members and plus performers, they all are requested to come on the stage for a group photo. Thank you very much. It was a lovely evening. And I appreciate, thank you very much, and also Ontario 150 for giving us a very, very much generous support on this occasion. Thank you. Bye.
Good evening. Democracies working together. That's what CIF has been working for since its inception in 2007. And it gives me a great pleasure to welcome you all at this very special event today, celebrating inclusiveness and democracies. What we are doing today is celebrating 150 years of Canada, 70 years of India, and 25 years of Indo-Israel diplomatic relations, and showcasing the best of all the three countries. I thank the Our Honorable Consul General, Mr. Bhatia, Consul General of Israel, Ms. Galit Baram, our MP, Mr. Ramesh Sangha, and all the distinguished guests and speakers who are here. Due to urgent business needs, I have to be away in Europe, much to my regrets. And hence, please accept my sincere most apologies for not being able to join here in person today. But we thank you again, and I thank the province of Ontario for supporting us for this event, and we promise to do our best to bring our great democracies closer and closer together. Thank you very much, and have a great evening.